And I hold true to the one who breaks my fall and lifts me time and time again. Oh my God, so good, you never give up, you never give up on me. Oh, what joy I found because of your love, because of your love for me. Oh my God, so good, you never give up.
Hey, Family Life, welcome. Come worship with us.
Oh, we look to the sun, set our eyes on our Savior, see the image of love, sing His praises forever. Oh, we look to the sun. Oh, we look to the sun. Salvation tearing through the dead of night. See the kingdom burst into color at the speed of light. Freedom shaking up the atmosphere as the shadows fade into nothing as the day appears. Beyond the skies above, love reaching out for us, the everlasting one, Jesus our God. Oh, we look to the sun, set our eyes on our Savior, see the image of love, sing His praises forever. Yeah, sing creation. Creation waking up to kingdom come. See the hope of heaven shining like the rising sun. Now forever lifted up from death to life. There's no fear in love and no darkness in His endless light. Oh, beyond the skies above, love reaching out for us, the everlasting one, Jesus our God. Oh, we look to the sun, set our eyes on our Savior, see the image of love, sing His praises forever. Oh, we look to the sun, yeah. Oh, we look to the sun, yeah. Beyond the skies above, love reaching out for us, the everlasting one, Jesus our God. Beyond the skies above, love reaching out for us, the everlasting one, Jesus our God. Oh, we look to the sun. Sun, yeah. Oh, we look to the sun, set our eyes on our Savior, see the image of love, sing His praises forever. Oh, we look to the sun.
Not listen to the voices of the world, our bad thoughts that tell us we're not good enough, the enemy telling us the wrong things. God, we choose to look to You today. Oh, You call me. and no other voice will define me. 'Cause I belong to you, I belong to you, and by your blood I've been adopted, and I've taken on. And I need to be reminded, I belong to you, I belong to you. And though the enemy can't take what I have or change who I am, I belong to you. You know the enemy change who I am, I belong to you. Yes, I belong to you, and by your blood I've been adopted, and I've taken on your name, and I need to be reminded.
Jesus, we thank you that the enemy can't take what I have, Change who I am. I belong to you. Lord Jesus, thank you that we belong to you. And the enemy can't take what we have or change who we are because, Lord, we are your children. We're sons and daughters of God. Thank you, Lord, today for the powerful reminder of that song. And we just soak that into our hearts and believe you, Lord. We are children of God, adopted into your family, Lord. Thank you for, Lord, that assurance and that you've sealed us with the precious Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hey, Family Life, it's me, Jonathan, here, and I'm so excited because we have one big, big, big announcement for you, and it's called Home Church. We're so excited because we finally are able to launch our home church structure, our home church program, our database. We've been working so hard on this because we want to be able to bring the church to you. Because remember, the church is not the building, it's us. So we want to be able to bring the church, the sermons, the worship, everything to you so that you're not always having to come to this building, but we can bring it to you. But beyond that, we want you to be able to bring the church to your community. Now listen to this beautiful thing. Our pastors, Pastor Dan and Diane, started this church 14 years ago. And when they were preparing, they were asking God, God, what do you want your church to look like? And a big part of that vision was to have a lighthouse in every neighborhood. Did you catch that? A lighthouse in every neighborhood. Now we've tried different systems, different structures, different discipleship programs, but none of it has seemed to really fit this vision. But listen closely. This actually, we believe, is the fulfillment, the culmination of that vision in practice. Home church, church at home, is the fulfillment of this vision to have a lighthouse in every neighborhood in practice. How exciting is that? And you get to take part of it. Whether you want to lead one or attend one, you get the chance to take part of it. So go onto our website, fl-cc.com, scroll to Home Churches and click it, and it will take you to our website, all dedicated to home churches. There's an application process, an inquiry place where you can submit just like, I'm interested. There's also training videos for leaders. You see, we want to make this so, so simple. And all we're asking you to do is watch the service and talk about it. Every home church is gonna look the same. You watch the service and you talk about it. And some people have been asking, does this replace Sunday gatherings? And let me answer that right here. No, it does not. See, we offer Sunday home churches and weekday home churches. The only difference between the two is the video that you watch. For Sunday home churches, you get to watch the whole service and talk about the discussion questions at the end. And for those who have already seen or already attended the live service, if you want to do a weekday home church, you just watch a shorter video that we provide with discussion questions, like a clip, discussion, and you just follow that. And all you have to do as a leader is facilitate the group. It's a beautiful thing. You see, we realize here at Family Life that the church has operated for a bit too long with a mall mentality, where we try to get people to our building. But we believe in this Amazon society that it's time for us to bring the church to you. And now you get to bring the church to your community. So please join us for these home churches. Go on our website and just look at it. We've got home churches in a bunch of different cities and we're looking for more. So please reach out to us. Go on the website and join a home church. Lead a home church. It's so exciting and so simple. We'll make it so easy for you. So with all this in mind, let's enjoy this message from our pastor, Pastor Dan.
Hey, Family Life, so good to be with you today. I've missed on the Sundays being with you and speaking. That's what I do for about 29 years. And any pastor who loves preaching misses when he doesn't preach or she doesn't preach. But I know you've heard some great speakers lately, and I'm excited to be with you. As Diane shared last week, just going through a little healing process myself and just working with a counselor. And it's just one of those seasons. We have high seasons and lower seasons. And I just want to be honest and thank you for your prayers. Thank you for your encouraging words. They mean a lot. And I'm progressing, and I got a great support system, and I got a great wife, and I got a great church. And so thank you for your prayers, and we're just moving forward, and thank God for forward movement. Praise God. God is good, and He's always good, even in the valleys. And some of you probably are like me, going through a valley, and just didn't expect it during COVID season, but some of the isolation and some of the routine broken up and some of that affected me in certain ways. And maybe it's affected you as well in certain ways. And I just want to kind of right from the start just say, I'm with you. You're with me. We're together in this. And if you're going through a valley, we're trusting God. Let's trust God together that He's going to bring about something good. Praise God. Well, we're continuing the message today, The Church Unleashed, and this is a series from the book of Acts. I want to encourage you that the scriptures will be on the screen as well as you can open your Bibles or your smartphones or your dumb phones or whatever you have to Acts chapter 8. We're continuing from last week. And my wife so graciously stepped in last week and shared her heart and shared the message. We're picking up in verse 4, and it says this, "And Saul went wild, devastating the church, entering house after house, dragging men and women off to jail. He forced to leave home base. The followers of Jesus all became missionaries." They were forced to leave home base. Persecution, they were scattered all over the countries, and especially Samaria nearby. And when bad things happened, they made good out of it. They shared the good news everywhere they went. Wherever they were scattered, they preached the message about Jesus. What an encouragement right from the start that they were persecuted. They were hauled off from house to house into prisons. They were scattered and running from persecution. And when tough times happened, their faith kicked in. And they didn't bunker and hunker down. They looked for opportunities to see, God, what do you want us to do now? And so they shared as missionaries everywhere in every city and town that they went to. We're kind of scattered as well. Yes, we can meet on Sundays, but man, it's almost like you have to have a hazmat suit. It's almost like you have to have every two or three masks and face screens and CDC guidelines and hand sanitizer and signing in and all of this rigmarole on Sundays just to get in the building. And you know what? But we're doing our best and people are coming, and those who are coming are blessed and refreshed. All right. You don't have to wear a hazmat suit. Okay. It's a joke. But we do have to follow certain guidelines. And some of you are at home and some of you in home churches, which we're glad. But in a sense, we've been scattered. The church has been scattered. And what a reminder that when we're scattered, what does God want to do as we're scattered? How could God use us to be those missionaries, to be those people that are shining His light right where we're at? It's a good reminder that we have some home churches, and I'd love to encourage you to be a part of a home church. We have many home churches, and most of them are full because we can only add 5 people that are not part of the household. So I want to encourage you to, if you're at all inclined to host one or to lead or facilitate one, you may feel unqualified, join the club. I love the phrase of the old preacher who said, "He doesn't call the qualified, he qualifies the called." And it's true. He qualifies the called. And so I want to encourage you, feel free online to just say, "Hey, I'm interested in facilitating or hosting, or I'm interested in joining a home church." We would love everybody who feels safe enough to join a home church in somebody's home. And we're doing everything we can to have safe and healthy environments in those homes. All right. But as we're scattered, let's continue to say, God, what good could you bring out of that's the first point. What good could God bring out of this? What good? There's good things. What good could God bring out of this COVID season? Home churches are scattered. In fact, we've got some great reports. Diane and I are part of the Butler's home church at their house, and we're gathering with a few people, and we worship. And sometimes we worship and worship and worship and pray and minister to one another, and it's so refreshing. God is just binding our hearts together. We've heard reports that are just seriously breakthrough reports for people that are going through some deep things. We've heard some miracles and words. We've heard a story of a man who him and his daughter were estranged for the last 2.5 years. He's a part of a Puyallup group. And his group prayed and said, "We're praying that there's reconciliation with you and your daughter." Again, 2.5 years, they haven't communicated. That night, she texts him. Come on, what are the chances that his own daughter that night would text him and say, "Hey, Dad, I'm reaching out to you, just kind of trying to connect with you." wow, that happened that night. There are great things happening. When we isolate, we stagnate. And so I want to encourage us not to isolate in this time. What is God wanting to do? Well, it shows us in this chapter, verse 7, that there's a new apostle emerging named Philip. And he is, in fact, verse 7 says, "For with shrieks impure spirits came out of many, and many who were paralyzed or lame were healed through the ministry of Philip." Let's expect that there's things that God wants to do that we have not even seen yet. Let's expect that. They were scattered all over, and so they used the opportunities in Samaria. Now, Samaritans were, tell you what, the Jews looked down upon them because they were half-breeds. They were married in with Jews, with some Samaritans, and so they looked down upon them. They had prejudice and discrimination against the Samaritans. And yet God spread his people all over Samaria, and they shared the good news and found out, wait a minute, this good news is for everybody. Even the unlikely ones, even the ones that seem to be too far off. Who in your life seems to be like, they're just way too far off. They're way too gone. There's no way that God could save them. He saved Samaritans that they thought they would never, ever have the opportunity. They never should have the opportunity. The Jews said, hey, this religion and this faith is only for us. Jesus offered it to them. They rejected him and crucified him. So he said, let's offer it to everybody else. So it was offered to everybody else, and they received the good news. Sometimes it's the unlikely ones. Sometimes it's, in fact, number 2, are there people that seem to be too far off? And how do we actually, point number 2, how do we look at those who aren't like us? How do we look at those? How do we treat those who are not like us? My son Jonathan and I have both mentioned in previous messages and first 15s that sometimes Walmart is the best tester of how we look at others that are not like us. It's true, isn't it? Sometimes you just walk through Walmart and just don't pay attention, or sometimes I'm reminded, wait a minute, how do I look at these people? You see all the nations of the earth walking through Walmart in Federal Way. In fact, they have a mask rule. Everybody has to wear a mask, but I wish they had a rule of everybody actually should wear shoes, and everybody actually maybe should consider not wearing pajamas to Walmart, and maybe everybody there, maybe there should be a requirement that people wear undergarments, right? I mean, we see anything and everything at Walmart. It's a great tester of how do we look at people that are not like us. I found myself sometimes judging, not happy to say that, but then realizing, wow, these people are people that God loves as much as he loves any of us. He loves them so much. They crossed racial barriers. It took persecution for them to cross racial barriers. They were not wanting to reach out to Samaritans. It took persecution, but it also took love to actually tear down the cultural barriers. It took persecution to cross the cultural barriers. It took love to tear down the cultural barriers. And God's love is the only remedy that's going to cross the cultural and tear down the barriers. And if people ever needed the love of God, they need it now. If we've ever needed the love of God, we need it now in these turbulent times. In chapter 8, it goes on to speak that Peter and John came from Jerusalem to pray for Samaritans to receive the Holy Spirit. See, the Samaritans received the gift of salvation, but they hadn't received the gift of the Holy Spirit. So they called back to the headquarters in Jerusalem and said, Peter and John, come. And as they laid hands upon them, they received the gift of the Holy Spirit, were filled with the Holy Spirit, spoke in other tongues, had the gifts of the Spirit available and flowing through them. It's a reminder that even when there's persecution, even then when we're going through troubles and struggles, that the fullness of the Holy Spirit is available to us. My counselor that I'm meeting with regularly right now, he reminded me recently, he said, Dan, are you speaking in tongues? Are you praying in the Holy Spirit? That's one of the best things we can do. If you haven't been filled with the Holy Spirit, you can receive the gift of the Holy Spirit and be filled and be able to pray in the Holy Spirit, pray in tongues and have gifts of the Spirit completely available to you. Paul the Apostle said, I pray in tongues more than you all. And so it's reminded me lately to pray in the Holy Spirit more and more and more. That is our connection, our heavenly language with that when we don't know what to pray, we pray in the Holy Spirit, and it's available. You can reach out and somebody online right now can pray with you to be filled with the Holy Spirit, or at the end of the service, reach out to any of us at the church, myself, my wife, any of your close friends, any of those that you know, and they would love to pray with you. Last year we said from Brian Houston, his book says, there is more. There is more. In his Australian accent, there is more. There's more. Let's receive the gift of the Holy Spirit and be praying in the Holy Ghost. In chapter 8, it goes on to speak in verse 9. Now, for some time, a man named Simon had practiced sorcery in the city and amazed all the people of Samaria. He boasted that he was someone great. That was the first problem. Verse 10, and all the people, both high and low, gave him their attention and exclaimed, this man is rightly called the great power of God. That's scary. This man is rightly called the great power of God. When Simon saw that the Spirit was given at the laying on of apostles' hands, he offered them money. Point number two, mistake number two. And he said, give me all this ability so that everyone on whom I lay my hands may receive the Holy Spirit. He was known as Simon, the great power of God, or Simon the sorcerer, or Simon Magus, or Simon, Magus, Simon the magician, the great wizard. He was known as, he's all that. And then he saw Peter and John lay hands, and they were filled with the Holy Spirit, speaking in other tongues, and had the gifts of the Spirit flowing. He said, I like that. I want to pay for that. And Peter and John rebuked him. See, he had this besetting sin of craving for power and fame. He wanted power and fame. What do you want? In fact, what is our besetting sin? I believe some of you say, I don't have any. That's probably it right there, pride. We all have some besetting sin or some temptation that seems to be our greatest temptation. I'm finding that my greatest battles really are not from without, but from within. The giants within. I don't even think that the enemy is our greatest battle. I think ourselves are our greatest battle. What is our greatest temptation? What is our greatest besetting sin? That if we're going to sin, it's this. Sometimes it's obvious things. Sometimes it's obvious things like outwardly lust or greed or covetousness or sometimes it's selfish, outward selfishness and pride. And sometimes it's our motives that we don't quite see, and then we realize later on, wow, that's not good. What's our besetting sin? What's the battle? What is our greatest battle? What is our greatest battle? Simon reminds us that we all have a battle to fight. Thank the Lord that there's answers. He moves on to say, they continued to preach in every Samaritan town as they passed through Jerusalem. Persecution was rampant. Danger was imminent. The apostles amped it up for Jesus. Do we amp it up? It's not normal, is it? When persecution happens, it's not normal. When we're going through valleys, it's not normal. It's the opposite of what we feel. They amped it up and said, okay, we're going to be scattered. We're going to have to leave our homes and leave our neighbors and leave our relatives. We're going to have to leave everything we know and go to a total foreign city. But they amped it up and they said, What's God going to do? I want to remind us, let's ask some good questions. In the midst of our trials, in the midst of our pain, in the midst of our valleys, what does God want to do? What does God want to do? As I'm preaching to myself right now too. I'm saying, Dan, what does God want to do through this? God, what does God want to bring about? Who does God want to help through our challenges, our struggles? As we struggle and as we depend and as we see God's hand move in our lives, what does God want to do? Who does God want to help through our challenges, through our victories, through our weaknesses? Who does God want to help? The disciples, it was go time. It was go time. Verse 26, now an angel of the Lord said to Philip, now that's pretty cool, isn't it? Haven't had an angel speak to me. I've had God speak to me in many different ways, but he had an angel that said to Philip, go south to the road, the desert road that goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza. So he started out, and on his way, he met an Ethiopian eunuch, an important official in charge of all the treasury of the Candake, which means queen of the Ethiopians, a pretty important man. This man had gone to Jerusalem to worship, and on his way home was sitting in his chariot, Reading the book of Isaiah the prophet, the Spirit told Philip, go to that chariot and say, stay near it. It wasn't this profound, complicated directive. It was simple. Angel said, go to that road from Jerusalem to Gaza, the one that goes from Jerusalem to Gaza. I want you to go right there to that desert road. Go south to the road. And then you'll hear and you'll find out what's going on. And so literally Philip did that. He just, and if an angel spoke to me, I think I would do it too. But some of us say, I'd like an angel to speak to me. Well, draw near to God, He will draw near to us. As we draw closer to Him, He draws closer to us and He speaks to us in ways. And I'm not saying He'll speak through an angel. Wouldn't that be cool? But don't hold your breath, all right? But He might speak through the Bible, through prayer, through circumstances, through the Holy Spirit, through others, through a message like this, through the first 15 in the mornings. God will speak however He wants to speak to get the message to us. Philip heard Him, went, and he heard that he was reading Isaiah. He's reading from the book of Isaiah, the prophet. And so he learned, wow, okay, now I understand why I'm here. So he ends up listening and hearing, oh, here's my ministry. He's reading from the book of Isaiah. Wow. It wasn't complicated. He just needed to hear and then go and do. When God sees one, He saw the Ethiopian eunuch, He sees many. When God sees one, He sees many. What I'm saying is this, is that Ethiopian eunuch was the one who was the treasurer of the whole country of Ethiopia. God had a plan and said, if I can reach him, I can reach a bunch of people in his country. God sees the one, but He sees the many in the one. God was working things for the good for the Ethiopian and for all of Ethiopia, that He would open up that country to the good news. Number three, He doesn't work only for our benefit, but works for the good in our lives so He can work for the good in others' lives. He works for the good in our lives so He can work for the good in others' lives. What is God trying to work for the good in your life? What is God trying to work for the good in my life? Can we just ask that right now? And as I'm speaking, I'm not speaking from the mountaintops. I'm speaking from a valley that I'm going through. And maybe there's a bunch of you, I'm sure, that said, I'm in the same boat. I'm going through a valley. I'm going through a healing time. I'm going through a testing time. I'm going through a depression time. I'm going through a discouraging. I'm going through a sick time. I'm going through a lonely time. I'm going through a hopeless time. I'm going through whatever you would fill in the blank. But I know many at the sound of my voice are going through a valley as well. And I just want to encourage you that what is God trying to do and what is God trying to work in you and I through this? It's easy to then get really self-focused. I've done a lot of that. But God is wanting us to actually look and say, God, what are you trying to do in me? For me personally, it feels like a new wineskin. It's like He's wanting to pour new wine in me, but He's wanting to change. He's changing the wineskins because I believe He's preparing me and He's preparing many of us for the future, for what God wants to do to give the greatest glory and honor to Him so that His power would be seen through us. But there's a breaking down. For me, it's this wineskin. Probably the best way I cannot explain it, that He's changing the wineskin so that the new wine can be poured in, the new ways, the new things that God wants to do to be glorified, to be lifted up through my life. And we forget about that, don't we? Oh, it's so nice to hear. Oh, thanks, Pastor Dan. But that doesn't just say goodbye to the problems, does it? Oftentimes, God doesn't rescue us from the problems. He walks us through the problems and tests us and allows us to experience the trials. And I'm reminded in James chapter 1, count it all joy. Wow, everybody smile. Everybody smile. Count it all joy when we're falling into diverse trials of many kinds, knowing this, that the trial of our faith works patience. How many would really actually not really want patience? Don't pray for it because God will test you. The doctors are the ones with the most patience, by the way. Ha, funny. But patience. He works patience and endurance in us through the trials. What is that next step that God is showing us and speaking to us and saying, maybe it is that I want you to trust me. Maybe it is I want you to find hope in me again. Maybe it is I want you to connect with a home church and not isolate anymore. Maybe it's I want you to attend Sunday services. Maybe it's to take that step of forgiveness of a loved one or forgiving yourself. Maybe it's to actually visit a doctor and say, I feel depressed. Would you evaluate me? Maybe it's to call a counselor and to say, I need help. As I shared with you, I'm meeting with a counselor right now, and it's been so incredibly helpful. Maybe it's reaching out to somebody that you've had a broken relationship with, and you reach out or you write a letter to them in some way so that you forgive and don't have anything against them. Don't hold anything between you. Maybe you're praying for a sick child, or maybe you're feeling sick yourself. And the next step is, I'm going to just step in and I'm going to actually partner with people for my healing. Whatever it is, what's that next step that God is directing you to do? And it might be just a simple step like Philip, just go to that road. What is that next step? He happened to be in the right place at the right time because God spoke and directed him. As God does, we'll get in the right place at the right time. Verse 36, as they continued down the road, they came to a stream of water. The eunuch said, here's water. Why can't I be baptized? What a great request of Pastor Philip, Apostle Philip. He ordered the chariot to stop. They both went down to the water and Philip baptized him on the spot. When they came up out of the water, the Spirit of God suddenly took Philip off, and that was the last the eunuch saw of him, but he didn't mind. He had what he came for and went on down the road as happy as he could be. Wow. He happened to be in the right place at the right time. Philip did because he heard from God and did what God told him to do. He took the next step. And this Ethiopian eunuch was baptized, was received the message of Jesus because Philip simply heard and did what God told him to do. Are we those kind of people? What an example to hear what God is saying and do what he's asking us to do. See, it's one thing to hear from him. It's another thing to do what he says. And some of that in our own lives is just very practical steps. Are we hearing from him and then doing what he's asking us to say? Verse 40, Philip showed up at Azotus and continued north, preaching the message in all the villages along the route until he arrived at Caesarea. It's interesting that Philip shows us that he just continued to actually hear from God and do what God asked him to do. How do we hear from God? Great question. We hear from God in home church. We hear from God as we read our word and pray. We hear from God on the first 15 on Facebook every morning at 9. And if you can't watch it at 9, you can watch it anytime later during the day and just connect with God. That's why we do it. You can connect on Thursday nights here in person or Sunday mornings here in our building. Those are ways to hear from God. God wants to speak to us. What is God saying? In fact, let's pause right now and just ask him, God, what are you saying right now? God, what is our next step? God, what is that very thing, that very next thing you want us to do? Thank you that you have healing for those who are sick in body, soul, or spirit, or in relationships. God, you have hope for the hopeless. God, you have joy for those who are downtrodden, depressed. You have encouragement for the discouraged. You have a plan for all of us that, God, you want to work out things for the good because we love you and because you want to work it through us to those that we love around us. God, work out those things in us. Show us the very next step. Show us where we maybe gone off the path, but show us how to get back on the path and take our next step with you. Thank you, God, that we also not just don't do this for ourselves, but we do this for those that we value in our lives, those that we influence in our lives. We do it for them. God, I thank you that this moment of prayer is a healing time. It's an encouragement time. It's a time to receive your peace and your hope and even joy. Lord, no doubt there's people that have not maybe received you as their Savior and Lord, or once did, they've fallen away and they want to come back. If that's you right now at the sound of my voice, I want to just pray a prayer of recommitment or a restart of our relationship with Jesus. If that's you, just pray with me this prayer. Say, Jesus, I'm so sorry. I've done wrong. Please forgive me and take my sins away. Be my Savior and the leader of my life. From this day forward, I will follow you. Come into my heart. Thank you for removing all my sins. Help me to follow you in Jesus' name. Amen. If you prayed that prayer, I want to encourage you to text the number on the screen, text BELIEVE to the number on the screen. Or if you're on our online platform on our website, go ahead and raise the hand and request prayer. Raise the hand and request prayer, and they will pray with you right there. All right? God bless you in your new commitment to Christ, or maybe you recommitted yourself. We're here for you. Praise God. We're going to listen to a worship song right now, and feel free to just soak in the message of this song, and then take time afterwards to discuss the discussion questions with those in your house. God bless you.
Let's all sing this together. Sing greater. Questions on your screen, so discuss with the people around you and have a great day.
Sing this with me tonight.
surrounded by